Assalamu alaikum, and thank you everyone who will join our live session over the next few minutes. I'd like to begin by acknowledging the traditional custodians of the land and pay my respect to their elders past, present, and emerging. Today we have with us Shaykh Rami Ansour. Shaykh Rami, for those of you who've never heard of him, is a scholar, counselor, public speaker, teacher, and translator of Islamic texts. He spent 7 years in Mauritania studying Islamic studies at some of the foremost Islamic colleges. Shaykh Rami has received his ijazah to share his wisdom with students. And in addition to that, he studied fiqh. He's also completed an extraordinary in-residence experience, allowing him to research questions and look at fatwa of the Islamic faith, law, and practice. He co-founded the Taiba Foundation. If you've never heard of Taiba, I encourage you to go to their website. Some of the work and the courses and the programs, which inshallah we'll talk about shortly, blew my mind. And I think that, you know, it would be amazing to see them roll out globally. I don't know if people are doing that around the world, but it would be awesome to hear about that. And it's the first organization in the United States to offer distance learning programs in Islamic education to incarcerated men and women. Shaykh Rami has extensive experience in curriculum development, specifically in character, akhlaq, and holds a bachelor's in human development with a focus on early childhood. He has also obtained a master's in educational psychology, and he is a resident of the San Francisco Bay Area, where he lives with his wife and three children. Thank you for accepting our invitation, Shaykh Rami.
Thank you for inviting me.
So we invited you as part of our Connected Communities series to discuss our role as Muslims and how we avoid polarizing narratives around domestic violence, abuse, and other types of harm to individuals, families, and communities. And the reason I say we want to avoid polarizing narratives is often, in my experience, when you talk about these issues, there's always a counter, or you might end up in a Facebook argument, which, you know, I'm usually the first person to just eject. And sometimes it's hard to really hold your tongue when you feel compelled to talk about social justice issues. Mm-hmm. So before we get into the heavier stuff, I thought it might be nice for our audience who might not be familiar with some of your work to discuss some of it. So In Shaykh's Clothing and your work with Taiba Foundation. Now, the first initiative for me that I was exposed to and I was very surprised was when I went on the website for In Shaykh's Clothing. For those of us who haven't heard of the term spiritual abuse, can you help explain what that is and how it may happen in Muslim communities, centers, and places of worship, and kind of, I guess, give us a context for why you established In Shaykh's Clothing or co-founded?
Okay. Well, I'd like to, and thank you for bringing up that the topic of spiritual abuse, because it is one that's very important for us to recognize, to know how to prevent, to know how to work on intervention, to know how to work on postvention, and for ourselves, within our families, within our communities, our organizations, masajid, and so forth. I would like to mention that I'm not the co-founder of In Shaykh's Clothing. I did contribute some videos and some articles and answers, and had a number of discussions with the founder, Danish Qasim, but I wasn't the founder of that particular website. I will say that, you know, before the website was founded, I was planning on writing an article, and I was going to title it In Sheikh's Clothing. So, like, to spell sheikh, like the old Hollywood way of S-H-E-I-K-H, and then make it sound like sheep, but say In Sheikh's Clothing. So I was working on that article. I had the ideas because I had experience with a community leader who, it took me a while to figure out the dynamics of what was going on, but then once I realized it and was far back from the whole situation, I was able to start analyzing it, and then to look into our tradition and our books and what our scholars have talked about for over 1,000 years in mm-hmm. terms of how people manipulate the deen, how they manipulate others through the deen, through positions, you know, the fake sheikh, so to speak, the fake sheikh. And so I was going to put this all together as an article and title it In Sheikh's Clothing, like a wolf in sheikh's clothing, a play on in sheep's clothing. And then when this website was working, they had asked me about that article. And I said, you know what? Why don't you use the title of that article for your website? So they took that, and, you know, it was kind of my donation to them. But other than that, you know, I have been in contact with the two people behind that program, Danish Qasim and Dania Shakfa. They've done amazing work, and a lot of resources have been collected, and they're definitely pioneers in this work and bringing awareness to our community.
I mean, thank you for the correction. Now that you've told me both of the co-founders' names, I'll be sure to hit them up for our next live session, because okay. I think there's so much we can learn. And I saw some of the resources you're referencing, like the code of ethics and things organizations can be looking at. Yeah. For those, it's interesting. So you had a direct experience. And I think sometimes when you're in a situation, it's very hard to know. I find that not everyone is able to objectively analyze things or get a sense to trust that intuition to say, something doesn't feel right. This isn't okay. Yeah. So just to kind of contextualize what that is, because I think it doesn't just manifest between a teacher and a student. It might manifest even in a relationship between a parent and a child, or a husband and a wife. So what is spiritual abuse, and how does it most commonly happen?
Yeah, a very good point that you're bringing, because you were talking about the polarization of discussions, and now even this topic becomes like, you know, something for the Facebook trolls to jump on and say, oh, this is part of Western feminism, liberalism, and so on and so forth, and it has nothing to do with our deen. And then other people are taking their definitions, you know, from the extreme other end of the spectrum. Whereas for us as Muslims, we always go back. We say, you know, as one of the texts that I studied, one of the first text I studied in Mauritania, the Murshid al-Mu'in, the helpful guide by Sidi Abdul Wahid ibn Ashir. And in this end, he has a section on the purification of heart. And he said, we should always weigh our thoughts. وَيَزِنُ الْخَاطِرَ بِالْقِسْطَاسِ. He or she, the person who's treading this path of seeking a higher level of connection to Allah, the path of ihsan, that we weigh our thoughts, every thought that comes into our mind, by the scales of sharia, and to say like, okay, let me do that. So that's why we have to kind of suspend our judgment, step back and say, hold on, let's look at this. So spiritual abuse is a term, and I've looked at, there's these interesting tools that Google has, and I've looked at like the term spiritual abuse, at least in the English language, and its use as a term goes back to the 1800s. So it's not new, it's not something new. One of the arguments that I make is that, you know, from the Sharia, we have a term, you know, an idea of istilah, technical terminology. So when we look at something, we say, okay, what is the meaning? What are people trying to capture through this term? Whether or not you agree with that term, but, and so multiple different people will define that term in different ways. Some people specifically use it to refer to the abuse of power, or the abuse of a religious position within society. So abuse by an imam, by a sheikh, sheikha, female, male, doesn't matter, an ustaz. So that position of trust that's given to an individual in the community. So certain websites like In Sheikh's Clothing, when they use the term spiritual abuse, that's what they're referring to. So they have on their website the definition of how they use that term. There's other websites where they specific and they keep it, even in the Christian communities, where they'll use spiritual abuse for abusing positions of power within the church. Other folks will have a more general application of it. And there's a good interview with Selma Abu Ghdeiri. And if you're, you know, for those of the viewers who are not familiar with her, she's also, she's big in bringing awareness and intervention programs about domestic violence. She's in the East Coast here in the U.S. She's a therapist, and she works very closely with the imam of the masjid there, Imam Muhammad Majid, which I mentioned I like to have my books in close, to be able to, I was going to mention one of their books, but they co-wrote a book called Before You Tie the Knot. And it was a good book about marriage, preparation for marriage, because it has the imam figure who's trained in Sharia and also has that experience, that community experience. And then Selma Abu Ghdeiri is a clinical therapist. So she has that experience, but she has a good article online. I encourage the viewers to read that interview. And she goes into her experience of seeing spiritual abuse, not only by the religious leaders, but also the families, like you said. Mm-hmm. And when I heard that, I said, you know, from my direct experience, for example, pulling books off the shelf, I have a book that I tra- and I didn't intend to plug this book. It's called The Rights of Parents. It's a book that I studied in West Africa by Sheikh Mohammed Maulud on Birrul Walidain, the rights of parents. And subhanAllah, after every time I've taught this book, it's had a similar effect. And if it's adult learners, children, it has one effect on them. But if it's adult learners, the number one question that I have, you know, people realize, oh, wow, there's this huge responsibility that I have towards my parents. But the number one question I get is, what if my parents were abusive? How do I balance between this parent who can literally trigger me with a look, even as, and I've had grown men break down in tears in front of me and says, I can't even go to my dad's house for Eid because he could say one underhanded passive aggressive comment and just trigger all that emotional trauma. And that he said nothing physical or sexual, but it was a lot of verbal abuse, you know, a lot of and that's abuse nonetheless. So so I heard this multiple times where people are really living in toxic environments. And there's a book called Toxic Parents. And that's what I would suggest, you know, when we read the tradition of Islam about respect to the parents, to balance it out with saying, yeah, but at the same time, we have some toxic parents out there who may very well, because they know our tradition, they will manipulate that. And so one of the triggering things will be like, you have to do this and don't do that because I'm your parent. And what does Allah say in the Quran? And so they're manipulating the deen. So when I see that, that's, I consider that spiritual abuse, that they're manipulating the deen for an ulterior motive that's not their right. So that's how I would define spiritual abuse.
I mean, and that's a really good example, probably something that might be a lot more common and unspoken. You know, how do you explain to people when you're an adult that this is the dynamic? People, I know I grew up in a culture that was like, don't air your dirty laundry. Don't tell people what happens right at home stays in the home. And I think what's so hard about that is oftentimes maybe people who are experiencing abuse might think they're the only one. Yeah. Or this is uncommon, it's just my family. So you carry shame, there's a secret, and it becomes so hard to actually figure out, how do I navigate this challenge in my life? Another common experience, Shaykh, that I want to unpack with you is when couples, I mean, I love that you said there's a book called Before You Tie the Knot, mm-hmm. because we developed a program for couples called The Binding Knot.
Oh, wow, okay. I'd be so interested in learning more about that if it's available, you know, to share.
Inshallah, I'll definitely have that conversation, inshallah, and connect you with the team. But part of the thinking was there's a lot of family breakdown. And sometimes couples might want to access support. And you might have one partner who's more invested and saying, let's go to couples therapy, or let's see a psych, or let's get some help.
Yeah.
In my experience, more often than not, it's the woman saying that, and the husband will say, no, we'll go to a sheikh instead. Yeah. And so, you know, I guess anything is better than nothing. And unfortunately, I think people treat shuyukh like they're the one-stop shop. You, mm-hmm. There's this pressure that you have to know how to be a psychologist, how to be a sheikh.
Economics, politics, child raising, parenting, marriage, the counsel therapy, karma techniques, you know. But if somebody has a heart attack, they're not going to the sheikh. You know, yeah. Somebody gets their leg built, you know, bit off by a shark over there in the waters off the coast of Australia, or over here in California, you know, by a great white out here. They're not going to say, wait, hold on a second. Don't call the paramedics. Don't call 911. Let's call the sheikh. No, nobody's saying that. So, but it takes time for people to realize that, you know, it takes to have that sheikh as the hub. The way the image that I have, you know, when you there's the legend in Western literature of King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table, right? That he brought in a round table instead of like an oblong or a rectangular table with the king at the end, you know, to where it's equal. And it's a legend. And, you know, whether or not it's existed or was impacted by truth, Allahu A'lam. But we know in our tradition, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam sat in a circle, a halaqa, with his sahaba. And he was so equal with them in the way he dressed, in his mannerisms, that somebody new to seeing him would walk into the majlis, the gathering of the Prophet, and would say, which of you is Muhammad? And that should remind us that, like, okay, there was no distinctive clothing, there was no distinctive chair, there was no distinctive, he was one of the people. And yet at the same time, they had that deference to him and that reverence, While on the other hand, if there were times where they felt this is strategy, like at the wells of Badr, where should we make our camp for the Badr? Or in other, there's many other examples where the Sahaba did speak up and say, you know, this, here's my opinion. So we have this tradition of like the Sheikh, the all-seeing Sheikh, the Wizard of Oz type Sheikh, you know, that he can do everything. And I'll, you know, there's one story. Here's a story of spiritual abuse and DV, since I know you said we're going to get into a discussion about that. So there was a sister who told me that she was in a physically abusive relationship. And when she opened up to the Sheikh, so she went to the Sheikh, and you know, from working in the community, that first step of opening up to somebody beyond the doors of your home is a huge step. It takes courage that has to be worked on for weeks or months or maybe even years. And that one time, that first like cry for help and just reaching out, if it's not handled properly, it could cause the person to go back in and then possibly never open back up. So it's very, very important that it's handled properly. So when she went to the Sheikh to complain about this, that my husband is beating me, the thing that he responded to her with was, just remember, the angels will curse you all night if you refuse intimacy with your husband, which is a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but that's not the context of what he's saying using it here. So It's a misapplication of our beautiful tradition, of the beautiful hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I would consider that to be spiritual abuse. When abuse, the way I look at it from my understanding of the Sharia, is taking the right of another person when you use the element of deen in it, in that process, that's spiritual abuse. So if this person is basically, this sheikh in this situation is basically condoning her husband's taking of her right, and he's throwing in the element of her religion, that's an abuse of the religion and it's spiritual abuse.
Do you think that some of that occurs because we don't really understand domestic violence? We just see it. We don't understand it's about control, power and control. It's about maintaining fear. Do you think that some of the shuyukh are interacting with this issue like it's a normal marital problem?
Yeah, they're interacting it with, you know, one of the things, and I spent almost 10 years in a seminary type education. So I'll give you one example. The Mukhtasar of Khalil that I studied in Mauritania, I spent 4 years studying fiqh. And the longest chapter is the chapter of nikah, marriage. 7 months. 7 months, that's all I was studying. Not in Mauritania, they don't do multiple subjects. So if you're studying fiqh, it's just fiqh. On the weekend, I would do other sciences and other subjects. But when I was 5 days a week, you know, all throughout the day, it's fiqh. It's legal, rulings, jurisprudence. And for 7 months, it was the bab of nikah, everything that had to do with nikah. But now if a couple has a marital issue that requires counseling and somebody who's trained in knowing how to help this couple navigate through what they're dealing with, you can't take a seminarian, a graduate from a mahdara, which is the name of a madrasa, you know, the Islamic university or Islamic college, whatever you want to call it by in English, and then say, okay, now apply your skills. Because what we were taught was the rules about very specific limits, hudud, of what's obligatory, what's sunnah and so forth, what's haram, what's prohibited, and what I also realized later on in after working in the community is that those rules actually establish like baseline limits to where if there's a court type situation or if people want arbitration or mediation, to say, okay, here's the baseline, let me show you the baseline, but you need to be over here. But a lot of that training in terms of how to help couples, it's not it'll be like the closest thing that I could say is if a couple is having a marriage issue and instead of going to a counselor, they go to a lawyer. Now, what's the lawyer going to do? He or she is just going to say, this is your legal rights. These are your obligations. And that's it. Now you make your choice. They give you the limits to work within. So what happens is that, you know, as people graduate from the seminary, that in the one hand, when they're given their ijazah, in the other hand, they should also be say, like, know your limits and know your scope. And going back to that Knights of the Round Table, the way that I see the sheikh, the seminarian, the madrasa graduate, the expert in Sharia, they have one seat at the table. So we need to have the therapist, the counselors, the DV experts, the marriage and family therapy experts, the psychiatrists, the community leaders, the community activists, and we have this. And then yes, when it's a matter of halal haram, clear defined limits, turn to those experts and say, what's the limits? And then now as a group, we can now figure out, okay, how are we going to apply those in this situation? But a lot of times they don't, that's not happening.
Yeah, it's a challenge, because in those situations, sometimes couples are seeking to repair whatever is broken, mm-hmm. and it's really not clear cut. And I think it's a challenge, because if someone sees a person like, you are going to be the person to help me, I think I definitely wasn't socialized to turn people away. I was always socialized to be in service of others, but you have to be honest about what you do and don't know, and when something is right. beyond you. So I really appreciate this idea of the circle, both being part of our tradition and perhaps, I feel like they've made movies with this concept of the night and the round table.
Yeah. Because the round table.
Reminder. Yeah. It's a really good reminder that we have to be holistic in our approach. And unfortunately, I mean, you've shared some awful stories. I've heard plenty of awful stories where women are told either be patient, or they're told relinquish your rights, and we'll grant you the khulut. So don't fight for anything. Just be happy, be satisfied.
Yeah.
You can just be given this. So unfortunately, that occurs even when women are saying, but none of my rights were fulfilled in this marriage.
So, and in those situations, those people, they're not even representing even the Sharia, like even their position. They're not even representing the Sharia properly. When I hear that, when people say, when the situation has come and says, oh, just give up your rights, afu, forgive people, it's better to forgive. It's like, whoa, hold on one second. You're presenting one element of the Sharia, and it's very like, there's this cartoon where a person is looking through the fence through this one little hole and says, oh, I can kind of, I see what's going on the other side of the yard. And this other person who's looking at the top of the fence, like, no, it's a completely different view from up here. And so if a person, so let's just take that Islamic concept of forgive and forget and give up your rights. Okay, that's looking at it through here, through like one little hole. Just say, hold, let's widen the scope and say, we do have this element of forgive, but have we ever been taught, like, I'll ask you a question. We always talk this concept of husnul dhann, having a good opinion of other people. Have you ever heard of, in the Islamic tradition, of having su'ul dhann, having a negative opinion?
No.
Have you ever heard of khutbah? Have you ever heard of seen an article? And yet it's deep within our tradition from the days of the early days of the Salaf, where they would say, beware of people with su'ul dhann, starting out with the negative opinion. And Sidi Ahmed Zarruq says there's three places specifically where you should have this: in your wealth, in your deen, your religion, and with your family. So when you send your kids to school, and just because it's an Islamic teacher, if your kid comes home and starts saying, well, he was mean to, oh, no, that was the sheikh. Like, hold on a second. Like, for me, when I send my kids even to an Islamic environment, when I come back, what did they say? What did people do? Did anybody touch you? Just like without traumatizing them by letting them know that there are those type of monster predators in the community, but just say, hey, what happened? And not giving the husnul dhann, the benefit of the doubt, to that situation or to that group or to that Islamic school, whatever, saying, no, we're starting out with like the su'ul dhann. But that element is in our deen. It's in our deen. It's a part of our tradition. And in fact, the ayah that talks about beware of su'ul dhann, it says, ijtanibu kathiran min adhann. Leave a lot of suspicion of su'ul dhann, which indicates there's a certain element there's a certain healthy element to retain. And it's these type of terms like have a good opinion, forgive, cover the faults of your brother, that in one element has a very objective meaning. In another sense, it has a very subjective meaning. So what does it mean, conceal the faults of our brother? Absolutely, like all of the time of our fellow? No, there's certain areas where we're supposed to, mention and warn and tell people about. But what happens, and this is one of the key things in spiritual abuse, whether it's by shuyukh, sheikhat, female sheikh, people in religious positions, or just people using the deen, they take subjective terms and they apply them objectively in an instant that they're the objective principles is just by their own nafs, their own selfish definition of what that means in that situation. So the sheikh that tells a person, cover the faults of your husband, forgive your husband. It's like, why don't you start at the baseline and say, here is your right per the Sharia. Like in the Maliki school, for example, if a husband calls his wife a name, a foul name, one time, it's grounds for divorce. If a husband gives his wife the cold shoulder, just doesn't speak to her, it's grounds for divorce. And there's a whole listing of darar, like all of the harms that could happen in marriage. One of the basic foundational hadith is la darara wa la dirar. There's no harm and there's no reciprocating of harm. You can't bring, you know, do something harmful to somebody else. And some of the ulama, you know, like there's the 40 hadith traditions where they say, if you want to summarize Islam into 40 hadith, here they are. And that's what Noah we did. Well, some reduce them even down to more, to 7 or 6 or 5 or 4. Some of the scholars who reduced them to 4, they said one of the foundation of those 4 is the principle, there's no harm nor reciprocating of harm. La darara wa la dirar. And in the Mukhtasar of Khalil, which is a text on Maliki fiqh, he says, وَلَهَا التَّطْلِيقُ بِالضَّرَرَ الْبَيْنِ. She can demand divorce and be given divorce, and a divorce can be enacted with when there's harm, when harm has become apparent, when it's clear. Which means there's evidence to support it. So if somebody comes to me and say, okay, look, sister, here's your right. Here's your rights. Here's your obligations. Here's where we stand. What do you want to do? You know, and respect the autonomy of that individual as opposed to imposing my decision on her or, you know, him and say, oh, you should forgive or you should. No, let's just start with the baseline. This is where the Sharia gives you. Here's the difference of opinion. Here you go. Now you can make your informed decision. I can give you advice. Now in this situation, I could advise you. You want to forgive him? That's fine. I mean, we went to there was a sister who complained about, she came to the community where I was a part of, this is about 15 years ago or so, complained and about her husband. And she wanted to stay with him. But it was a very convoluted situation. And there was a lot of details. Without going into all the details, she said, okay, I'll go back to him. Well, then she calls up some of the people in the community and says, no, I want to leave. And now she has a black eye. So we went to that house, a group of people, and we helped escort her and got her away from that situation and helped her get reestablished. And although in that situation, I would have said what we should have had is police presence with us when we did that. But it was also because, you know, again, coming out of a seminary, you're taught what are the rights of people. You're taught to defend the rights of the oppressed. But now in terms of application in a modern context, what should be taught is like, yes, you can be there because she's coming to you as the community religious leader, but call the authorities because that situation could have gotten bad.
Yeah, of course. It's so interesting. As you were talking about that concept of, and did you say it's called su'uddan as a van?
Su'uddan, yeah. Su'uddan, like evil. So su'uddan is the opposite of husnuddan. So okay. Husnuddan is given the benefit of the doubt. Husnuddan, like if an imam shows up, you know, to apply and they say, you know, what I should think is like, is this guy a child molester? You know, should I run his social security number and make sure he's not a child molester? Somebody else might say, hey, brother, have husnuddan. Say, no, this is a religious position. I want his social security number. We're going to run it in the database. He might be a child molester. And so my assuming that possibility is called su'uddan. The other person who says like, we shouldn't even do that is husnuddan.
This concept for me, because I've always been taught about have a good opinion of others. I've never heard kind of, it's like a scale, right? Where there's balance. And I've never heard this other opinion, which is fascinating to me because I think that's probably why there's so many people who are manipulated. And there is harm because we're not really taught those important life skills or even Islamic concepts that are like armor. They equip you to navigate all sorts of social situations. I'm wondering if the reality is we're not even teaching those concepts, whether it's in our family units or in our community centers or places of worship. How do we start to address religious leaders? Like, I didn't even know that, right? And I've heard some repeat offenders in terms of religious leaders who always see the victim survivor the advice is those horror stories. So you know who they are. How do we address that behavior where they're enabling the abuse to continue? They're enabling the idea that it's acceptable for men to occupy this position or authority within their family unit, where they're imposing particular restrictions, maybe to public life or independence of their wife or their daughters, or sometimes even their sons. How do we start to address it when they sit, I guess, in that position of power, and we almost treat them like they're untouchable, when really, like, we're all human beings, we're all fallible. I'll make mistakes, you'll make mistakes, but it's like you're almost not allowed, and you will you'll be reprimanded with a religious idea of have a good opinion.
Stop. That's the Sheikh. Stop. That's the Hafidh of the Quran. Stop. Don't, you know, you don't want Allah to be angry with you. Again, subjective term in the sense of, we don't want Allah to be angry with you. Why are you stopping criticism with a very general, broad term that has many different applications? And all of a sudden you're wielding this mighty lightsaber sword of don't let Allah be angry with you, and whew, cut down the criticism. So the first thing is as you said, to, you know, realize that people are human beings. Religious people in religious authority are human beings. Parents are authorities, are human beings. Our spouse is a human being, and we're all fallible. Mm-hmm. We believe in the prophets and the messengers. We believe in the characteristics of the messengers. One of them is infallibility, isma. The prophets cannot do sins. The messengers don't do sins. They can make human mistakes, but they can't do like egregious, you know, like do the haram and infractions of the Sharia. And so if we believe that of the prophet, let's not apply this to human beings. And especially in very closed circles where the Sheikh is put up on a pedestal, whether it's in a formal like Sufi tariqa, or maybe even in a jihadi group, or whether it's in a masjid with, you know, the sheikh on the pedestal, it could be in any form, or it could be a sheikha, a female sheikh that has like all these, you know, people serving her day and night, you know, to get the barakah. Whenever they put up the pedestal and they prevent criticism, that's when the dissenting voices. To me, the story of the emperor's new clothes. Are you familiar with that story?
Yes.
So to me, that's like that's one of the things, you know, there's a lot to be learned in literature, but whether it's through literature or even in our tradition where we have dissenting voices, people did ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wait a minute, you know, and if they can go to the Prophet and say, wait a minute, you know, this doesn't make sense to me, and he could either correct them or go with their opinion or wait for revelation, but he allowed this, you know. To me, when my reading of the seerah, the Sahaba were not pushovers. They were not people who were easily duped. They were not people who gave up their rights. You know, sometimes some of the big Sahaba would both go to have their dispute resolved. And the Prophet never told them, hey, veil the faults, you know, forgive and forget. He arbitrated between some of the major Sahaba, and he never told them forgive and forget, you know, this. So where did this culture come from? I think that it comes from ignorance of the Sharia, like an in-depth study. The majority of people who hold positions of religious authority, imams, khatibs, even muftis, don't have a deep understanding, and I'm speaking about myself as well, don't have a deep understanding of the Sharia. So how do we address that? By having a group of people. So instead of having, you know, just one sheikh, just say, let's get a second opinion, third opinion, fourth opinion. And then let's also let the sheikh figures, the teacher figures, recognize there's other experts in the communities whose voices need to be heard. They need to be heard. So when it comes to a matter of, say, religious, like say marriage or domestic violence, spousal abuse, whatever it might be, to have those multiple voices. So again, going back to the before you tie the knot, it's the voice of a therapist and an imam, sheikh, you know, and so they're working together. And if you have multiple people working together, that's where I think so going back to your original question, how do we do this in a community? One is to allow for criticism and allow for pushback. So this is another thing that I point out to people. There's an ayah in the Quran, a verse in the Quran that says, "Lawla daf'u Allahi an-nasa ba'dahum bi ba'din lafasadatil ard." If it were not for people, or actually, if it were not for Allah pushing back people through like having people push back with each other, there would have been corruption in the land. And there's another narration, difa', in another qira'ah. لَوْلَا دِفَعَ اللَّهِ النَّاسَ بَعْضُهُمْ بِبَعْضٍ, if it was not for the pushing back of Allah. So what does this mean? This means that when something is presented, an idea, a motion, a judgment, there should be room for pushback. And so if it's in a marriage, parent-child relationship, husband, and so this is what I tell people. I said, if your parent does not allow for pushback, you know, respectful pushback, there's something wrong in the relationship. Mm-hmm. If your spouse does not allow for pushback, there's, because that's a natural order that Allah has placed in this earth. If your imam, and I've seen people, parents get furious if their children have give them pushback. I've seen shuyukh just get like at their core furious if somebody just gives pushback. And I say, whoa, that's not from our deen. Like I never got that from the sharia, from the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that if somebody, you know, gave him pushback, that he would just get furious at his core. That to me is when I read about narcissism, that's what narcissists do. And so just like a sheikh can have a heart problem, he can also have a narcissistic problem. So how do we balance that out? How do we balance what the good they have to offer with the possible harm that could come from them, is by having multiple people and saying, you know, turn to the sheikh or the sheikha, the sharia expert, and say your opinion, okay, the other opinions, and then as a group, where that's where we come to a decision of what are we going to do in this situation.
I mean, there's a lot of it creates, I guess, the idea you're proposing, checks and balances.
Exactly. Thank you.
The group regulate each other, they hold each other, we're a mirror for one another, we hold each other accountable. And I guess it's also a great space when you have someone else who has knowledge in a particular area. You can couple what I know with what you know. So there's so much benefit in just the idea.
Yeah, and let me ask you something. Have you personally ever heard a hadith? And what is your profession by, if I might ask, like your background or your experience in life?
So I've done community engagement work, but I studied human resource management. So I guess people.
Okay, people. All right. So now when you, with that training and reading, have you ever come across a hadith, a story from the seerah, a story amongst the sahaba, and when you read it, something from your profession just resonated, and you're like, wow, subhanAllah, here's the Prophet talking about that 1400 years ago, and now 1400 years later, they're teaching this very same principle as one of the epitome of work ethics. Have you ever had that?
Absolutely. I'm not going to say it in Arabic because my Arabic is shot, but the concept of everything is by your intention. And there's this whole industry now that's mobilizing around business and change culture. Everything's about intentionality. And it's like intention is such a core principle.
Core, yeah.
SubhanAllah. So,
which is, it's that hadith is one of the other two that if we were break down to four, so it's no harm or reciprocating harm, and actions are by the intentions. So from your experience, when you had that voice needs to be at the table because you have insight into certain elements of the hadith or the ayahs in the Quran that other people don't have, that the shuyukh don't have. And I'm going to give a few examples. We're not talking about defining the limits of like a fatwa of what's halal and haram, but it's more of like, okay, if here's the halal and here's the haram, and we can make a choice in between here, right? Here's the clear limits. What are we going to do? Mm. And that's where we need to hear those other voices. I'll give you an example. There was let's start at the early generations. Umar radiallahu anhu, he stood up to make a proclamation, an executive order, or an executive decision, and he wanted to cap the dowries that women were being paid, because as the Muslim community became more affluent, you know, throughout the spread of the Muslim empire, the Khilafah, people became more affluent, the dowries started rising, he wanted to cap it. A woman mentioned to him a verse in the Quran that was a clear proof, because it said, even if you give women a storehouse of treasures in dowry, do not hold back any portion of it. And so even though that ayah is talking about to the guardians of the women, the awliya, if you're given something as a dowry, don't hold it back. So that's the initial ruling. But what's implicitly, what's implied in that ayah is that it's okay, it's permissible to give a storehouse full of gold. And so Umar said, radiallahu anhu, he retracted his statement. He said, everybody has more knowledge than Umar. Now, there is some weakness in the chain of that story, But the principle is sound, that we have multiple instances of Umar and other Sahaba retracting their statements when somebody who was of less knowledge gave them insight. And there's an Arabic saying that says, you might find in the river what you don't find in the ocean. قَدْ يُجَدُ فِي النَّهْرِ مَا لَا يُجَدُ فِي الْبَحْرِ. And so a person from the community might come up and say, you know, remember this hadith. Or you might have a person, a scholar of the highest caliber, but he just overlooks something or he forgets something. There's a famous story Ibn al-Jawzi mentions about Abu Hanifa, which is Abu Hanifa when he went to Hajj. Now remember, Abu Hanifa is in Baghdad. He's in Iraq. So he's not like the people of Hijaz, or definitely not the people of Mecca, who are doing Hajj and Umrah all the time. So when he goes there and it's time to shave his head, he goes to the barber and he puts his head down and gives the barber the left side of his head. And the barber said, he said, don't you know you start with the right side? And then he taught him, Abu Hanifa said that barber taught him 5 sunnahs of shaving the head that he did not realize. Not from lack of knowledge, but just from application. You know, if Abu Hanifa knows 100,000 rulings or 1,000,000 rulings, but this barber knows this area. Yeah, look, I don't know anything else, but I know the sunnahs of shaving the head.
Yeah.
And not just through knowledge, like experiential knowledge and practice and application and so forth. And so that voice needs to be at the table. If somebody were to say, well, he's not a sheikh. Like, well, he taught the sheikh. You know, and Abu Hanifa recognized his knowledge in that domain, in that arena. So that's what I would say too, that there has to, you know, insight can be given when we're strategizing, when we're trying to figure out what are we going to do for our community.
It's remarkable to hear that, because I think there's something so humbling. Even if you occupy a position, you're at the pinnacle of your career or the position of power that you're in, it's humbling to know that someone who might have just a finite amount of knowledge on a very specific thing can be the person that gives you that aha moment or that new learning, subhanAllah. And I guess we can all learn from anyone, even if you cross paths with them for a short time. I'm wondering about your thoughts. I know that you've done a lot of work with Taiba, and I do want to get to that before we get to the end of this conversation. We developed a program in The Binding Knot, and what I loved about reading about your work on the Taiba website was that it was evidence-informed, people with different professional experiences, and that you had it peer-reviewed. And so I think just having that high level of discipline and structure and effort behind a body of work is very important. So I really appreciated that, especially because we tried to have a similar level of discipline behind the Binding Knot program in building it, because we didn't just want to go, oh, let us tell you a little bit about relationships and it's going to be some self-help stuff, but there was nothing that really underpinned that body of work, right? Mm-hmm. What we found in our experience though is we built this program because we're seeing a lot of family breakdown. We're seeing it at the crises end where there's a lot of family dysfunction, there might be some DV, and people are at the point of going, we need help or getting a divorce. And there are all sorts of stressors in situations like that. So for us, it's like, how do we prevent our community from even ending up at that end? Well, we cultivate what the life skills and their knowledge at the very beginning of that journey. But what we found is women write to us all the time and they express interest. And we say, both you and your partner, you know, your fiance, your husband need to come together for this program. And 90% of the time, the woman is ready to sign up. And she's like, but my husband is not keen. My husband said, we don't really have problems. Why do we need to do this program? My husband is really anxious or embarrassed about doing this program and like publicly doing that. What will people say? And so I'm interested in, you've worked a lot with men. In your experience, like, how do you cultivate that buy-in with men to participate in life skills programs and help them see that you don't only need to take in your life spiritual instruction or advice from shuyukh, like there's also that, it's what you said, the two parameters, right? There's a whole life in the middle and you have to live it.
Yeah, definitely. Well, thank you for taking the time to review our website and to look at, you know, some of the programs we offer. Some of the programs that we offer, we've developed ourselves. Some of the other things we take from currently existing programs. So some of those programs that you're referring to that are peer reviewed and, you know, evidence based. It's not we haven't done any, we have not worked with any universities to conduct, peer reviews of our programs. But we are using programs of other organizations, you know, that work with, that, that address these life skills issues. And they have done their due diligence with like the evidence, like just a, as an example, there's this, this is one of the courses that we have yet to roll out, but it's called the PREP, Walking the Line. It's a book about marriage specifically for prisoners. Because there's a whole set of dynamics for incarcerated men, and what are they, you know, what are they facing? And that has, I think hundreds of research articles about the efficacy of that program. There's other programs like, for example, we have the WRAP program, the Wellness Recovery Action Program. It's not something we've developed. This was originally developed by Mary Copeland to help people live with depression. But then it had applications in other areas. So then they applied it to the reentry population. Reentry is a term in the US that use. In Australia, is it different for somebody coming back into from prison into free society? Do they say reentry?
I mean, I understood the lingo, but I used to, in another life, work for the police force, so.
Okay, all right. So do they use that same lingo, reentry?
They talk about people being released into the community.
Released, okay, released from custody. So, So the, you know, to have a wellness recovery action plan. What you're saying about the hesitation of having those type of programs, especially for men, I've seen that. One of the ways to address that is through normalization, is to have the people who do have that insight, who have opened up and say, look, you know, we, you know, just like we can turn and, you know, go study Sharia, study the Quran, study Hadith, we can also turn to these other programs and get the benefit from them. And when you show that the Sahaba, even the Sahaba like Umar radiallahu anhu, sent people out specifically to learn medicine from the Byzantines, the Rum, at that time, and he sent two people out for 2 years, and he said take notes about everything. And when they returned after 2 years, he said, now place that on the scales of the Sharia. You know, what we accept, what we reject. So interestingly enough, although a lot of people cite the Muslims and the golden age of Islam, and although there's a disagreement about even the use of that term, because some people will say, well, we were still at our epitome of studies and research beyond what's considered the golden age. Anyway, without getting into the polemics of that term, but people will say, oh, we were so great at medicine. Interestingly enough, the Muslims excelled in every area of medicine except for surgery. And the reason why they did not excel at surgery is because of the long-standing prohibition of practicing surgery on cadavers, on dead bodies, because the Muslims have a clear tradition. We don't cut the bodies. We don't even mutilate the bodies of our enemies who have fallen in the battlefield after they've tried to kill us. You know, you respect the human body, you bury the human body. So that tradition stayed for up until recent, you know, post-colonial era, where Muslims started and you start seeing fatwas and say, well, you know, it's okay. But for almost 1400 years, the fatwas across the board were clear: no cutting of human cadavers. Therefore, Muslims didn't have the ability to practice surgery. One Muslim did excel historically in surgery, and he worked on practicing on ape bodies. And that's how he got good, because that's how surgeons get good at their training. They work on cadavers. In any case, I just use that as an example to say how the Muslims were not, inhibited from learning from others. They were not intimidated. Mm-hmm. You know, when they went into the lands of India, they were not intimidated by Indian medicine or Greek medicine or Persian medicine. They said, let's learn this. And let's sift through it with our Sharia. So in the same way, when we talk about wellness and recovery or substance abuse, we just recently published at Taiba, and I can show you a copy of it, but an Islamic approach, it's called Overcoming Addiction, an Islamic approach to recovery. It has a spiritual-based, tazkiyah-based 12 steps. It also has, and both of the authors are currently in prison. They're both recovering from in recovery from substance abuse. But that's an example where, you know, if somebody says, oh, I have an addiction problem, and he goes to the sheikh and he says, sheikh, I have an addiction problem. Give me a fatwa, give me advice. I would, if betting was halal, which it's not, we know that, but if betting was halal, I would wager money, a lot of money, that most people in positions of religious authority, teachers, serious students, you know, طلاب العلم, طالبات العلم, whatever, by whatever name, they're not going to know how to respond to that. I didn't know how to respond to that until I understood addiction at a, you know, after years of studying addiction. And I'm not certified, but I have a certification to facilitate friends and family support groups for people who have loved ones who are addicted to substance. But after, you know, some of our students in Taiba, they've fallen deep into addiction, and I've seen the repercussions. I have one of our best students. I mean, Islamically, he was one of the best students. Tahajjud every night, memorizing books of fiqh and Quran, memorizing hadith, but he didn't address his underlying addiction issues. When he goes back into free society, he falls back into his addiction as an unhealthy coping mechanism, and it leads him into a bad mixture of drugs, a psychotic break, a criminal act. 37 years in prison now he's facing, 37 years. And so that just sent me on a journey of like really trying to understand addiction. And so now, when we talk about addiction, it has to be a pro. It's not as simple as saying, oh, it's haram, you should stop it. Astaghfirullah, it's haram. No, addiction is a disease, just like heart disease. You can't tell a person, hey, you know, just say astaghfirullah, make some dhikr, and the heart disease will go away. It has to be treated. So what I would say in terms of recovery groups or self-help groups, support, or even just self-help books, one of the things that helps is for people who have accepted that to be comfortable talking about it. And when they talk about it, then it normalizes, like, oh, it's okay to talk about addiction in the masjid. Yeah, it's okay to talk about addiction in the masjid. It's okay to talk about DV in the masjid. Yeah. I'll give you an example. One of my mentors who had a big influence on me when I was in high school, and I was involved at the MSA, Muslim Students Association, at the high school level. So he would come in for like Jum'ah talks, and you know, I would ask him advice all the time. Later on, one of the organizations he founded was NISA, the North American Islamic Shelter for abused women. And he said when they first started having their fundraising dinners here in the San Francisco Bay Area, they would invite the imams of the masjid, and not a single one would attend. Wow. Because maybe, oh, it doesn't exist. After years and years of, you know, one imam saying, oh, actually, you know, let me start attending these training seminars. Let me these awareness. Let me give a khutbah about it, you know, little by little. 10 years later, now there's always a full table of imam representatives at any of their fundraising dinners that they have. So it takes time to awareness, you know, to build, to normalize it, and to say, hey, this is an issue. We have it in our communities. Let's talk about it.
That's very heartening to hear, because I think it's very easy to go, here we are trying to prevent the harm from even occurring, prevent family breakdown, prevent DV, prevent whatever issue that might be plaguing our families and communities. And when you get the lack of response, I think sometimes it's like, oh, maybe we missed the mark. Maybe people are not interested, or, you know, you start to doubt the value, or what you have to contribute, or whether you know the product's great, but whether people are actually going to take it up. And I hear what you're saying about it does take time. I'm wondering about normalizing. You said one way to do that is to normalize programs, normalize different, like you have some programs, and I hear that you've distinguished what is yours and then what are some other programs you've taken on. The character reformation programs on your website, are they specifically designed by Taiba?
By us. Yeah, by okay. Taiba.
So with those programs, for example, I read one of them was anger management. There was some stuff around cognition. And I mean, mm-hmm. you're essentially, it's psychoeducation. You're teaching people about the language and how to understand their thoughts and their feelings. And so how have you found the engagement with those? Is there resistance? Is there willingness? What is that experience?
There's a lot of initial resistance. But what I found is that, you know, when people, when they come to me specifically, or other faculty here at Taiba, we have a number of teachers that work with the incarcerated and formerly incarcerated, or even just when we're working in the community, when they come to us, they're coming to us as that, you know, for lack of a better term, to go back to that original where we're, you know, the all-knowing sheikh, you know, the expert in every domain. And the solution they're looking for is a solution from the deen, straight from the deen. And so if I say, hey, why don't you go to a 12 steps recovery group? Wow, You mean the imam, the teacher, the sheikh? He's telling me to go to 12 steps, or he's telling me to go to anger management. So it's okay. So it's almost like a stamp of approval that, that they have to get from us. So that's why it's very important for the religious leaders to be part of the care team, whether it's in addiction treatment, mental health, you know, DV. We have to, the people have to realize, like, for example, if there is a DV response in a community, and say it's activist based, but they have a disdain for religious figures. And I'm going to speak from the American experience. There's this extreme left element of activism and liberalism that's really seeped into our community. And I'm going to say it, for lack of, you know, it infected our community, really. And I'm talking about like meningitis affected, it's getting into the spine and it's going up to the brain, and it's going to kill that individual. It's really toxic. And I've seen it firsthand, the intolerance. Like, I've seen the intolerance of the far right, the conservative racist, you know, the stereotypical racist. The intolerance from the far left is more pronounced, and there's more disdain than the far left. I mean, I was at a university, and I saw this. It was about educational programs for prisoners. And so I went to the university over here, and I saw the professor who was one of the, I had a question for her, and I'm going in, you know, I have a kufi, I have a kufi and a beard. So I'm visibly Muslim. But you know, in the eyes, I wasn't ready for this, but I see the professor, and she's smiling and laughing and joking with everybody. And then I have a question for her, coming from as a representative of an organization. I'm not just, you know, some random guy off the street. We've taught over 9,000 prisoners across the United States, delivered over 22,000 books and courses. Like, it's not just a simple thing. So I'm here to ask her a question. She turns to me, and she gives me the stone cold face of like disdain and disgust. And it was like, I don't know this person. I have not interacted with that person, but it was literally like night and day when she was answering the questions of these young ladies, these young students from the university, as opposed to when she sees me. Because what does she see in me? She sees the Muslim male. She sees the male. She sees the white skin, even though my father's Arab. I guess technically, you know, they're Arab. So she sees in her mind the patriarchy, the hierarchy, the white privilege, all of these terms, you know, the toxic masculinity, the religiosity. She sees all that, and just, she shows her disgust on her face. So I asked the question, but then I was like, I'm never going to deal with this person. I had other interactions as well with now that was a non-Muslim, with Muslims who are involved in the activist realm, but their intolerance is suffocating. And so the reason I'm mentioning that, and I kind of got off onto a tangent.
No, but stay here, just because I'm very curious and I have a follow-up question.
Okay. So when we have, you know, we were talking about the activist. Okay. So the activist, if they think that they are going to serve the Muslim community and not engage the religious leadership, oh, they got something else coming, you know. Then it's not going to happen. If they think that they can just brush aside religious leadership just because we're, what is the term, cisgendered heterosexual males, right? They're just going to push us aside, toxic masculinity. So their toxic femininity is going to blast our toxic masculinity out of the water, and just push us aside, and they're going to be the saviors. So it's not the white savior narrative. Now it's the, you know, it's the feminine savior narrative. And I've seen that attempts to happen. What has to happen is there has to be that round table to say, look, the majority of Muslims are, their faith is, they're deeply committed to their faith. Muslims are deeply committed to their faith. The first person they go to is their religious leader, male or female, right? The sheikh, the sheikha, the ustad, that's the, if they're having a mental health crisis, sheikh. Parent-child relationship, sheikh, sheikha. Spousal, sheikh. So we are first line responders. And two things have to happen. If the people who are now the second tier care givers, if they don't recognize our position as part of the care team, well, then we're not going to have that connection to where I can refer that over there. And then for this position of the religious leader, if they don't realize their scope and their limitations and know at a certain point you have to refer out, then that's also going to be problematic. So there has to be a balance in that.
I think there is an entire second conversation just on I think activism and the challenges in the modern world, because I think you're touching on some things that definitely show up in the conversation. So the last live I did was with another sheikh, and a man came into that and he asked a question and he said, oh, but what about violence against men? And it was so interesting to me because I think overwhelmingly I hear stuff like this all the time from men. And I understand that one of the prisms they feel that they're represented or seen through is this lens of toxic masculinity, you're violent. And does the data verify that violence against women is a global issue? Absolutely. Does it mean that all men are violent? No, it doesn't. No.
Is it predominantly men who are doing it? Yes.
Yeah. And so I think this is why at the very beginning of this conversation, one of the things I said is part of this conversation is to not be engaged in a polarizing narrative, yes, that we're able to have a conversation about a very important issue that is significantly impacting the well-being of our families and our communities. And I think I appreciate what you're saying about sometimes when we take a position, it can be to the point that it infects our own soul. And I have been that activist, which is why I laughed. I have been that activist who was so mad at the imams because I felt the failure or the lack of engagement or the lack of response. And so this is why I think we as young people turn to alternative ideologies and ideas. And I identified as a feminist for many years on all my platforms, almost as a way of just antagonizing the conservative parts of our community to say, well, we have a tradition that is so rich, but when we don't even respect it, we don't honor women through it, then women will find a way to reclaim their power and say, we are here and our voices matter. Now, how I experience the world and how I interact with my Islam and also all my ideas around women's rights and my place in the world as an activist have shifted. You know, they mature and you evolve, but I think not everyone is able to grow through the process because it's actually quite a painful one. You know, I was very fortunate, I think, in that I had some very good mentors and teachers that I could always come back and connect to. I don't think that that's a readily accessible thing for everyone. So alhamdulillah, I was in a very privileged and fortunate position to have these rich and often difficult and uncomfortable conversations. But I think there's two things we should talk about after today's live. One is the Binding Knot program, and the possibility of, you know, if you wanted to explore what that looks like.
Yes, definitely.
And then also, I think there's definitely, I think a conversation, I work with a lot of young people in Islamic schools and public schools around New South Wales. And I hear a lot of the questions that they ask. And I think there is a vacuum in talking about particular issues because they're too uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Perhaps sometimes we're walking the tightrope because on either end, someone might get angry. But I think that it's an important conversation. So I will send you a follow-up email, inshallah.
Okay. Well, thank you. I look forward to it. And, you know, learning from your experience there and what you said now, you just shared. And thank you for sharing that about, you know, the journey and how painful that is. And, you know, that it's, I mean, I think that's might be something that you want to write a book about or give some lessons. I'm actually intrigued. You know, I want to hear now the lecture series about that journey. You know, we started this conversation about spiritual abuse, and I know from, you know, going from within a paradigm where, you know, we have to serve the sheikh is right, and knowing intellectually, like there's some things that are wrong, but having to break free from that ideology, I know that was a very exhausting process. Yeah. Because it calls into question a lot of, you know, previous deeply held beliefs and giving those up. And that process of giving those up, it's mentally exhausting. It's even physically exhausting. And so I know that's a different path of what I went through. But I know that process is of giving up something deeply held is once you realize, no, I made a misjudgment over there or misapplication of what it is.
Yeah, subhanAllah, you know, I often think that sometimes we grow through our pain if we're able to take the wisdom and understand. I think for me, definitely all the things that I've struggled with have been things that have taught me profound lessons. But I really want to thank you, Sheikh, for this insightful discussion. Inshallah,
we'll be able to follow it up
with another one.
Yeah.
It's been an honor to host you and learn more about some of your work and get your perspective on this issue. And for those of you who maybe jumped in at a different point of this conversation, we're talking about marriage matters, domestic violence, family abuse, and how we address it, and just exploring different dimensions of abuse in our communities. I want to thank everyone who joined the live. And I also want to remind you that at the end of this, as soon as I stop live streaming, I'm going to share a link. If you have feedback, there's a survey, please give it to us. If you have suggestions for people we can bring on, we're happy to hear it. If there was aspects of this conversation that you really appreciated or you didn't appreciate at all, let us know. Those are things that we can learn from. And it'll definitely help us because this is a monthly series and we are currently approaching many more people in the coming months. And so it will only help us learn. Thank you so much.